Hello, my name is Dr. Brian Curtice. I'm one of the paleontologists at Fossil Crates, and I wanted to talk to you all about a paper I just finished reading about Meraxes gigas, aka this giant new Carcharodontosaurid from Argentina. So let's jump right in. First and foremost, it's named after a Game of Thrones dragon, the genus, and the species name means giant. It was found, interestingly enough, in a layer that was above that of Giganotosaurus, which is still the largest known Carcharodontosaurid, but below that of Mapusaurus, which gives Giganotosaurus a run for its money. The authors detail a number of characters that make Meraxes different from Mapusaurus and Giganotosaurus. What you see behind me is a Giganotosaurus picture I took in Australia many years ago, little oversized, but still large. The Carcharodontosaurus is from a new one that was recently created based on partial skeletal elements. And the one on the bottom left is done from the paper that just came out. This is made from new material. None of these skulls are complete. They're all composites, or their missing pieces were extrapolated from similar relatives. Just so you keep that in mind. So how large was Meraxes? Well, based on their specimen, which they have a lot of, they have the hind limb, they have the forelimb, they have a lot of the tail, the pelvis, and some of the skull, they determined that this animal was 4.6 kilograms, or 4.6 thousand kilograms, my apologies. And that comes out to be a little under 10,000 pounds, or just short of 5 tons. And what's really cool about this paper is they spell out the math that they actually used to determine the weight. So you can go ahead and look at their assumptions and check it. I like that about science. They were able to reconstruct the skull. They were missing the premaxillae, or the front of the snout, but they were using Giganotosaurus and other Carcharodontosaurid knowledge. They were able to reconstruct it, which works out to be 50 inches or 4 feet, 2 inches long, which is very long indeed, one of the longest skulls ever discovered. In fact, it slightly nudges out Acrocanthosaurus. Acrocanthosaurus is guesstimated to be at 123 centimeters or just at 4 feet in length, which is a stupendously long skull. But Giganotosaurus is much longer still. And what they were able to do with the great bones of the Meraxes was they looked back at the original Giganotosaurus material and figured out how long it probably was. Numbers have been all over the map. So in trying to figure out how long Giganotosaurus' skull is, they did some math. And first they looked at it and discovered that the Meraxes' skull is a little narrower than Giganotosaurus. But even if it's narrower side to side, that doesn't necessarily mean it's not going to be useful for front to back equations. And once they cracked the numbers and they started looking at them, they realized the Giganotosaurus skull is most likely between 158 and 169 centimeters in length. And they went ahead and used 162 centimeters, which is right in the middle. And this is at a 95% confidence interval, which is really great when you're working with statistics. You like to see that. And that makes it between 62 and 66 inches long. Either way, it's over 5 feet in length, even on the small side. So this is a truly gigantic skull. They then went ahead and looked at partial skulls, like the Carcharodontosaur over on this side. And it is truly a giant skull, somewhere between 142 and 160 centimeters. So the upper echelon of this individual still falls short of the Giganotosaurus, but even on the lower end, it exceeds that of Meraxes. They looked at Spinosaurus, and there's a Spinosaurus that is alleged to be over 170 centimeters long. This is 6 feet in length. This is ridiculously long. Recently, there was a challenge that has been made to some of that material's length. So stay tuned on that particular beast. But also keep in mind, you assume we find the standard deviation, the average size. And just like you have humans that are 110 pounds and you have humans that are 1,000 pounds, and you have elephants that are normally 4 tons, but some get 10 tons, it's quite probable that these lengths are just the average lengths of the adults, and that there were individuals that had larger skulls. Now, to put all of this in perspective, Sue, the largest of the T-Rex skulls, comes in at 140 centimeters, 55 inches. That is a gigantic skull. And Sue's skull is more robust. It is just massiver compared to the Giganotosaurus, which are giant, but in a way, they're kind of gracile in comparison. It's weird to use that word with such large animals. Meraxes was found in the Cretaceous rocks, the late Cretaceous rocks of Argentina in the Neuquén province. And it was found right on top of the layer of Giganotosaurus, and it may have lived right alongside Taurovenator, another dinosaur you may not have heard of. But it's very interesting to see how these large predators were coexisting. We see that in the Morrison Formation with animals like Torvosaurus and Saurophaganax, so we know what happens. And it is neat to see the diversity of the Carcharodontosaurids in Argentina is improving and growing every time they find new material, which is seemingly almost every week. It's wonderful. It's definitely a gold rush of dinosaurs down there. What always interests me is the Carcharodontosaurids didn't make it to the end. In fact, they died out somewhere around 80 million years ago. But why? No one knows. What's interesting is in South America, they were outcompeted by abelosaurs that do make it all the way to the end. In fact, the last of the Carcharodontosaurs, to my knowledge, is Xiao Qilong out in Asia, and it just makes it to the Turonian's end. So what happened? Do not know. So what's interesting is the Tyrannosaurs make it all the way to the end. The Carcharodontosaurs go extinct in Asia, and the Tarbosaurus and its ilk dominate, as well as the Dromaeosaurids. And in Western North America, well, Tyrannosaurids make it all the way to the end, as do Dromaeosaurids. And in Gondwana, the Abelosaurids, they're the big winners. So why the Carcharodontosaurids went extinct, no one knows. Speaking of death, what's really cool is they did a histological study on this. And what that is they cut some chunks of the bones apart, and then they counted the what's called lags, lines of arrested growth, and some other fancy histological terminology that basically had them predict an age. And this animal, our Meraxes, live between 39 and 53 years of age, which is crazy because that's almost double the Tyrannosaurus. And it seems to have reached such large sizes because it kept growing at a rapid rate at a much later stage in life. In fact, it didn't reach maturity until well after a Tyrannosaurus was probably dead. The oldest known T-Rex, which is roughly half the age of Meraxes, had a femur that's 20% larger. So think about that. T-Rex didn't skip leg days. It had some really big, massive, powerful legs on it to go along with that huge chomping skull. Not taking anything away from the Carcharodontosaurids, but definitely that Tyrannosaur robustness pops in the legs and in the skull. Now, Meraxes was the first of the Carcharodontosaurids that was found with a complete limb, an arm. And as a result, they did a really cool study. They looked at the arm lengths, the forelimb ratio. So you took the entire arm, humerus, radius, ulna, all of your wrist bones and your fingers, and they compared it to the length of the femur. And what they discovered is in Tyrannosaurids, you know, the butt of many jokes with its small arms, in Abelosaurids, whose arms are even tinier, and now we know in Carcharodontosaurids, the forelimb is about 0.4 ratio to that of the hind limb. And that's crazy. Here's three very distinct lineages, all with large skulls, and all end up with small arms. They suggest that the humerus in all of those three taxa is very large. You can see it on the Abelosaur. It has a very large humerus. It's longer than the arm. And that coracoid, that scapula coracoid, has muscle attachments. Well, if you have muscle attachments on one end, they have to attach to something, and they're going to attach to the humerus. So they conjecture that these large scap coracoids prevented the arms from getting even smaller in these large animals because the muscles had to go somewhere. And so that size of the muscles on the shoulder blade meant that the arms didn't get any smaller than 0.4 because the humerus had to be a certain length to absorb all of the muscles on the still large scap coracoid. I thought that was a really interesting, clever piece of work. These animals have giant heads and small arms, but we have our good friend Dinochirus, the giant ornithomimid, which has a small head and very long arms. We also have the Canignathid, Gigantoraptor, which has a small head and long arms. So we know theropods can get large and have long arms, but when they do, they have small heads. If they have big heads, they end up with small arms. Something going on there, and I'm sure that one of you watching this video is going to solve this mystery in the next few years. Statistically, they were able to demonstrate as the skull gets larger, the ratio of the femur to the humerus gets smaller, which was another interesting find. So it shows that as their heads get big, their arms get small in these particular lineages. Now they provided measurements and images of the hand claws, and the images are small and the hand claws are tiny. Certainly none of the mighty Jurassic meat hooks that a Torvosaurus or an Allosaurus or a Saurophaganax is walking around with, those huge honkers of the giant fingernails. Interesting as well, just to compare that these giant animals behind me, their hand claws were fairly small. In reading the paper carefully, I noticed that They point out on the largest toe claw, it's kind of sharp on the bottom. There's a ventral ridge, which is unusual. It's different from the other claws that are on the foot. And this number two claw was larger than the other claws. When I looked at it, I thought, huh, is that a hand claw? It was found on the foot, so we know it's not. But it was cool to see that it had large toe claws. So it might have been doing some kicking. Some other facts that they pointed it out was the sacrals are coalesced, all five of them, which is a sauropod guy, that's standard operating procedure. But in this theropod, it was pretty cool to see their whole pelvis in this big animal is all coalesced into one big block, which makes lots of muscle attachment a little bit easier. They also noted that the first two caudal vertebrae have some fusion going on, as do caudals three and four, the tailbones. And these four vertebrae have what we call a hypospheme-hypantrum articulation. It's basically a lock and key mechanism where they plug into one another and then they lock into place. So if you take the big sacrum and you have these articulations like this, you've got a very stable platform, which allows you to get a lot of power going out. And they also noted that these proximal caudal vertebrae have pneumatic characters in them, holes on the side, pneumatic fossae, lateral pneumatic fossae, pleuroceles, if you will. And that's pretty cool too. We see that in diplodocid sauropods all the time. It's definitely neat for me to see in a theropod some of these sauropod characters that I've been around all my life. And it also is a way of showing that that pneumaticity was going down in the tail. This giant animal was lightening itself in the back. I'm sure there will be many more studies of this animal coming out. The material is gorgeous. It was found in a mudstone with sandstone base, and it seems to have died in a very soft, muddy environment and was buried in a high-energy sandstone, which typically suggests a flood. So it was mixed up amongst Rebbachisaurid and Titanosaurid vertebrae, which are very obvious when you look at them. You can tell them apart right away. So this animal and these others died. We see this in the Morrison Formation quite often, the late Jurassic, and it's often attributed to drought. They died alongside of where there used to be a nice stream, and they die, and then the big flood comes in during the monsoons and buries everything. Possible. We'll wait for the geologists to come out with more of the information here. I hope you've enjoyed this long, detailed video on Meraxes. I wait for more papers to come out, and I thank Juan Canale and the entire crew for the wonderful work that they provided. And if you're looking for a way to write a paper, this is a great one to follow. Their methodology is clear. Everything is labeled, articulated, knowledgeable. The appendices are wonderful. It's just a great paper. I really enjoyed reading it. I'm Dr. Brian Curtice of Fossil Crates, and thank you kindly. Adios.